Niall, it's great having you back in Switzerland. I think last time you were in Montreux, am I right?
Yeah, it's been a while now.
Yeah, it's been a while, yeah. We all were shocked when we realized that you got cancer, and you also talked about this. Mm-hmm. Now, you just have published your autobiography. Did you realize that life is something that might end any day, and that you should write down your own memories? Or?
Death was all around me. Mm. I have a blog that I do. Once cancer attacked me, I didn't know what to do. I was afraid. Mm-hmm. So I started doing a daily blog because I wanted to talk to other people who were going through similar things. And I found a lot of old pictures and a lot of old music from the original Chic organization. And there's one picture that I post every few months or so, and it has the original five men from the Chic organization. And four of those five are dead, and I'm the only one left. Mm-hmm. Luther Vandross has passed away, Raymond Jones, Tony Thompson, and Bernard Edwards, and I'm the only other man in that picture. Mm. And I'm very aware of death being around me. In the rock and roll business, death is almost as common as losing your record deal. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It was important to sort of get this all down. Mm-hmm. And now, that wasn't the motivation, but once I started doing it, that was a good byproduct.
Mm-hmm. And now you're touring again, I guess, with all the royalties you get from all the hits you wrote, etc. One could consider Chic must be like a hobby for you.
Yes. Exactly.
A great professional hobby. Does it feel like this?
It's a wonderful hobby that I take very seriously.
Yeah.
Yes, it's pretty clear I couldn't make a living from Chic because we don't work enough. We don't go out on, we don't do long tours or anything like that.
Yeah.
We just go out and do different shows every now and then because I love it. It's just so wonderful to play music that I've written and produced, and to be on stage with a great group of people who love the music, to see the audience's appreciation for the songs, to make a few mistakes every now and then and have the people play along with it. It's great. When you become a professional musician, at least my age, the thing that you live for, the thing that you dream about when you're younger is, man, maybe one day I'll go out on stage and I play all my own music. Mm. And now that's happened to me. You know, I can walk out on stage and every song that I play, either I wrote it or I produced it, every song. Mm-hmm. And even if our show is 4 hours long, I still have another 4 hours worth of songs I can play.
Yeah. But what's the kick then of being a producer?
The producer is an interesting thing. It's, in my case, a producer's function is very well-rounded because I'm a musician too, mm-hmm. so I get to do the arrangements, I get to write the charts, mm-hmm. blah, 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 I get to perform. But had I not had those other skills, it would still be a fun, interesting job because it's my responsibility to turn in the project, just like the director of a film. Mm-hmm. So I have to be responsible for the budget, the performances, the edits, the engineer, everybody I hire, all the staff to make that product. Mm-hmm. So it's a big responsibility, but it's a fun responsibility. It's a responsibility I was made for.
Really? Yeah.
Absolutely.
Also budgets, because not every musician is familiar with, you know, accounts.
I'm great with budgets.
Yeah. Okay, I see.
No, almost. I own a distribution company. And very few of the people who work for me at the distribution company mm-hmm. are, matter of fact, none of the people who work for me at the distribution company come from the artistic side. They all are CPAs, certified public accountants. They're all from the money management side. Mm-hmm. Because basically, a distribution company, as you well know, it's sort of a bank. In other words, the retailers use my money and my credit and my good history of paying mm-hmm. to take records on consignment, because they believe that I will pay them, and then they sell them, and it's a mm-hmm. system that goes back and forth. So mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That you are very how do you say, very familiar with conceptual thinking. I also read in your book that that was part of the reason how and why you came up with Chic. You saw, I think, Roxy Music inspired yes. you and Kiss inspired you. Mm. And I didn't know that. I thought it's astonishing that these were like white rock bands mm-hmm. who were so much, who inspired you. Was there something subversive for you? That you know, like Berry Gordy, who thought we bring black music to the white masses, but we have to find our own way. Were you thinking the same way, or?
Well, what had happened?
Wasn't it about, you know, colors? Was it about just how can we make all these people dance and succeed without having like a front man, you know?
Right. Mm. The interesting thing about Roxy Music, which was the first time I got the idea for a concept like Chic, mm-hmm. was when I went to see them. They were playing at a theater called the Roxy, so it was Roxy Music playing at the Roxy. Yeah. They had this beautiful, stylized, fashionistic look about them. The audience sort of looked like Roxy Music. And I thought, man, that's incredible. This was what I called, and I told Bernard, it was a total immersive artistic experience, similar to when you go to a museum. You can go to a museum, and it doesn't make any difference what city the museum is in. Once you walk inside the museum and close the doors, mm. you're in that immersive experience. Mm. That space now becomes this new thing, even though outside it could be a war going on, or you could be, you know, in I don't know, Cairo, Poland, New York City. New York City, when the King Tut exhibit comes to New York, you're right in the middle of Manhattan, but when you walk in that exhibit, you're in ancient Egypt. Mm. And that's the first thing that I saw when I saw Roxy Music, that you felt like it was a carnival, like you were mm. at this place that they belonged, and now you can walk into their world. Mm. And when we saw Kiss, who was good friends with our keyboard player, Ace Frehley was, mm-hmm. We saw the same thing even better, because they put on makeup and it was even more like that. You went to a carnival. And once you were there, you were in the carnival world. Like when a carnival comes to town, you have to go into their world, even though they're invading your space. And then when they leave, the carnival goes away, the magic goes away. So while they're there, you're immersed in their world, and then they leave, and it's like, ooh, these magic people have left. Mm-hmm. That's what we wanted to do with Chic, because we didn't think that we were stars. So we had to build a framework that we could fit inside of. Mm-hmm. And we came up with this concept of high fashion and designer clothing and all that sort of thing, but meanwhile we were very poor. Mm-hmm. We wrote about it as if we lived it, and it's really interesting. If you look at the hip-hop movement, when hip-hop started, and even now, it's this sort of braggadocio. People talk about things that they've never even done, that they haven't even mm-hmm. achieved yet. They talk about it before it happens. Mm-hmm. And you know it didn't happen, because they're still just getting their first record, but they go, I'm rolling in the Maybach, I got 20 deep, I got this, I got that, I got money. Yeah, mm-hmm. some people who were drug dealers beforehand do that, but most people make up those lyrics because they're fantasy lyrics. Mm-hmm. They're things that you would like to achieve. And that's what Chic was. It was this mm-hmm. fantasy that we were able to role play. And that's what Roxy Music looked like to us, and that's what Kiss looked like to us. Mm-hmm. So we decided to take those concepts, mm-hmm. put them together, make them black, and it came out Chic.
And talking about escapism, the Studio 54 was a place to be, and I read now that Le Freak was written after you weren't allowed to get into Studio 54, is
correct.
That right?
Yes. We were invited down to Studio 54 by Grace Jones, mm-hmm. and she told us to come in the stage entrance, the artist entrance. And when we walked up to the stage door, the guy took one look at us, even though we were dressed great, and he told us to F off or if you're allowed to say it here, fuck off, either one. Yeah. So it was pretty obvious that he wasn't gonna let us in. So we went back to my apartment and we started jamming and we started playing down, down, did it, down, 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 down. And then I started singing, down, 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 ah, fuck off, do 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 do, fuck Studio 54, F off, do 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 do, F Studio 54, yeah. You know, and then we got elaborate with it, we wrote a bridge, and if a cab driver, cuts you off, down, down, F off, down, if your mother does this, down, 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 F off, down, and we wrote a bridge, and it was fantastic. And Bernard said, we need to turn this into a real song. I was like, wait, you can't do that. So we changed F off, the F bomb, to Freak Off, and that wasn't quite sexy enough, and then we changed it to Freak Out, and it just sounded perfect. And that's it, Freak Out stuck. And we made it an homage to dance records. Come On Baby, Let's Do the Twist, and another famous song called The Peppermint Twist. And we took those and mixed them together and came up with a dance song.
What was the freakiest thing, the weirdest thing you experienced in Studio 54? Because there are so many stories. Or don't you remember them?
The freakiest thing. There's no such thing. Every night, that's why Studio was fun, because every night was freaky. It was almost as if Fellini owned a nightclub, and Salvador Dali was the art director, and it was just crazy. It was just and Picasso was standing at the front door. It was just the most crazy things. So it was this beautiful living art experiment, but people were out of control, almost like Sodom and Gomorrah. So you could do, especially before AIDS, sex was rampant, because there was a very popular club called Plato's Retreat, which was an open sex club. So Studio had to have everything that every other club had. It had to be sexier than Plato's Retreat, cooler than the Playboy Club, more modern and hip than Regine. So, you know, it had to be everything. And that's what wound up happening. It had the music, the people, and the location, New York City, to become the center of the disco universe. And it did it perfectly. It did it better than any other club in the world. And believe me, I've gone to every other club in the world.
Was there a point when all these temptations became very dangerous for you?
Yeah, but you know, the hedonistic lifestyle that I was living only became dangerous for me much later in the 90s. So I lived through the 70s. Yeah, I had my incidents. My heart stopped eight times one night. You know, I've had two bouts of pancreatitis, all sorts of stuff, acute alcohol poisoning two or three times. I was at the threshold of death many, many times, but that didn't frighten me. What frightened me was one day at Madonna's birthday party in 1994 in Miami Beach. I went to her house, and I don't remember, people told me this story, but I was the last person to leave. Madonna, who was a great friend and the biggest artist I ever worked with, was begging me, no, please leave, there's no one here. People carried me to my hotel room, and after they carried me, I let them leave, and I went out to party even more. And I suffered from cocaine psychosis, where you hear voices, and that was the first time that ever happened to me. And it made me believe that I was crazy. And once I believed I was crazy, I knew that if I were crazy, I probably couldn't play music well anymore. I was really afraid of losing music. So I got on an airplane, flew to New York, checked myself into a rehab, and I was in the rehab for 8 months. Funny story, on my way to New York, I'm reading a magazine, and in the magazine is a story with Keith Richards from the Rolling Stones, who was my friend and neighbor. He lives in the next town, from me, where I lived in Connecticut, where the drug rehab was. And in this article, it said that Keith Richards was giving up drugs because he felt that drugs were an impairment to his ability to play music, just like me. So he could live without drugs, but he couldn't live without music. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, great. If Keith can do it, I can do it. Mm-hmm. I'm in the hospital for 8 months. The first day that I come out, I go to this restaurant to get some food, and the maitre d' calls me over and says, hey, Niall, there's a good friend of yours on the phone. And I'm thinking, how could that be? No one knows where I am. I'm underground, and it's my first day out. And it was Keith Richards. He calls on the phone. He goes, hey, Niall, hey, mate, you got a bump, which is slang for, do you have any coke? Okay. And I just looked at the phone. I was like going, how ironic. I partially get sober because of him. Yeah. And the first day I come out, he's asking me. But, you know, when you give up drugs, you sort of need those kind of tests. Because to have Keith Richards call and ask me for coke the first day was a big test because I knew I was finished. Yeah. So I just said, oh, no, Keith, I don't have any. I didn't want to get on a soapbox and act like, well, Keith, I'm the most sober person in the world and you should stop doing that because I don't think like that. Yeah. If I could still do drugs or if I was able to do them safely then, I would have probably never stopped. But it was dangerous for me and I had to stop.
One very last, very short question, because you mentioned Madonna, as you also produced Like a Virgin.
Yes.
After you worked with her, could you resist her virginity?
Could I resist her virginity? Yeah. Madonna wasn't a virgin when I met her, hardly.
I think she once said that she slept with many producers, but I think you were the one who was very straight and worked with her.
Yeah, you know, it's really funny because you know, there's a story in my book where Madonna and I have a big fight. And, you know, I quit the record. And one day she walks out of the studio as I'm leaving. And she says to me, you know, hey, Niall, do you think I'm sexy? And I was like, Madonna, of course. You're like one of the sexiest people I've ever met. Because at that point, we were great friends. We'd go everywhere and you hear people saying, who's that girl with Niall? Who's that girl? Who's that girl? And I said, of course I think you're sexy. And she just went, well, then why don't you want to fuck me? And I was like, because I'm your producer. And she said, and this is a quote, I say it in the book, she says, well, that didn't stop any of the other ones. And I just kept thinking to myself, you know, she didn't realize that my career as a producer, I had had many, many hits. The other producers that she had worked with, they're all good producers and good friends of mine, but their list of hits weren't the same amount as mine. And I had already worked with Diana Ross. Most of my hits were with women. The only hits that I had with men at that time were Duran Duran, INXS, and David Bowie. Everything else was with women. So at an early point in my career, at some point in time, I fooled around with an artist, and it wasn't the right thing because it, you know, it made things uncomfortable. So I thought Madonna and I would probably be working together for the rest of our lives because that record was so perfect. It's the biggest record of both of our lives. She's never done a record that big, nor have I. So it seemed like we were the perfect team to make records forever. The last thing I wanted to do was, you know.
Risk this.
Yeah, it was crazy. And also Madonna, I mean, you know, I hate to say things like this because it's sort of not fair because Madonna, I think, is amazing and I really do adore her and she's great. And if you look at videos of the way she was when we first met, that's how she was. Like the way she is now, I don't even know what that is, but I think that underneath it, she's still the same person I met. Mm-hmm. You know, Madonna, that young girl, you know, they always, it's like, you know, it's always like the super good looking guys. You know, it's like, that's not, you know, I'm not that dude. Like when I was working with her, I was doing a film. And the star of the film, she wanted to go over and meet him every day. You know, it was that kind of stuff. It's like, and he was the typical kind of guy that's like, you know. So I didn't even take it seriously. But had I taken it seriously, I wouldn't have done it because I was smarter than that. Mm-hmm. And plus I had a million girlfriends. Like, why would I have to sleep with my artist? It's like, I was out partying every single night. It just felt wrong. It felt almost like sleeping with your sister. It was the wrong thing. It was incestuous to me.
Yeah.
But it's funny. There are many women artists that I work with that actually have questioned why I didn't make passes at them, which I thought was really interesting. Yeah. because I grew up with the, you know, with the civil rights movement, the women's rights movement, the gay rights movement. I grew up socialized to be aware of other people's space and stuff like that. So it certainly wouldn't be my instinct. It's not that I don't think about it, but it wouldn't be my instinct to hit on my artist. It feels like sexual harassment in the workplace. You know what I mean? It's just like it feels weird to me, especially because we were partying all the time, and you know, I grew up in the Studio 54 era. There were just millions of just
opportunities.
Yeah, we just lived like that. It wasn't odd or unique. It's just how life was.
Thank you very much, Niall. And a commercial break. Niall Rogers' Le Freak is out now.
Yes.